continue the program, but in this lecture, you should expect that we should discuss some of the fundamental basics and theory of this GIS. So, this is introduction, so what I will do is, you know, I will cover most of the things which are very modern, some concepts. I will try to make some of the concepts very clear, you know. This is the division of the presentations on motivation, maps, you know, geodata, map projections, basic spatial analysis, topic and raster analysis, and then some terrain analysis and some case studies. So basically, GIS stands for Geographic Information System, a computer-based tool for mapping and analyzing feature events on Earth. Right? It's very important, it's a computer-based tool. So GIS manages locations, it's very important, locations, provide information, tools for display analysis of various statistics, including population statistics, economic development opportunities, and vegetation types. So the most important thing is that GIS allows you to link databases and maps and to create dynamic display. And in addition to that, it helps to visualize, do queries and do overlays and a lot of things. So basically, we are able to link, you know, spreadsheets with the spatial data and do analysis. And this is very helpful in planning also. So why do we need GIS? So obviously, the population is growing. There is an increased there is a lot of pressure on the efficient use of resources, and so you can see in this, you know, the population is went from almost from 3 billion to 9 billion, you know, in a very short span of time. Some of the things which we can do with the help of GIS. So in this case, basically we are looking at a lake which has, you know, shrunk, and you can see the images from 2000 to 2013. And that this is, we can see these images, and so basically GIS may be used to document change, mitigate damage, and effectively manage our natural resources. And this is happening due to the, diversion for irrigation, which has destroyed rich fishery economic bases along the seaside communities. Now, obviously, GIS can be used for disaster management and recovery. So, in this, we can see that, you know, this is an image of 2012 and June 23, 2004, and after the disaster, you know, tsunami caused this, disaster along this Indonesia. And you can clearly see that we can do disaster management and recovery. And this is one of the very important examples in GIS in public health. You know, GIS in public health. Air pollution is a major cause of sickness and death, primarily from nitrogen, sulfur dioxide, carbon and other gases. And these small particles basically goes into the lungs. You know, you can see these black dots. You know, this is basically, you know, slide of our lung. And you can really see these black dots are representing these, particles which reside in our lungs, and they can decrease our life. So GIS can be used to, so in this case, you are looking at the map of US, and average concentration of these smart particles, these are called as fine particulate matter, that is PM2.5, right? So this red color shows the area as we have maximum concentration, average concentration of these fine particles. So people who are living in this area, we have more exposure to these fine particles, PM11, you know, PM2.5, these fine particulate matter. And doctors and scientists are able to see that, you know, the people, and the average life of a person decreases by 2 years, you know, there is a increase in the lifespan for 10 gram microns reduction in exposure. So basically, what it says is that the less exposure we have to these, fine particles, there is an increase in the life expectancy. So there is a very good correlation, right? So GIS can help us. And in this slide, basically what they are doing, we are monitoring these particles from the satellite, and also, you know, on road also, this on the bicycle, this is a sampler which is going in the streets at different times, and it is again recording that. You can see that in the afternoon, the concentration, the red color is showing the concentration of these particles in the streets. So we can match our data with the we can match our data with the satellite data also, and on the streets also we are doing this. So these are some of the applications of the GIS, and this is giving us a motivation why we should learn. So various components of GIS. So GIS is composed of hardware, software, data, humans, and a set of organizational protocols. So for hardware, we need hardware for GIS. We need high-speed computer, large basically display, RAM, coordinates and input text devices, media, high quality hard copy graphic and text output devices, network and web data communication. As long as all of you know RGS, QGS, various softwares we have, and QGS is an open software, free. Basically that means that it's an open source software, that means it's a free software. And these are some common functionalities which are provided by the GIS software, that is data entry. You can do manual border capture, attribute, editing, manual command line, area features, data management, analysis like spatial query, attribute query, and different type of analysis. We are going to discuss these analysis and output we basically map design, layout, and all these things, these functions are provided by these various GIS softwares.
थोड़ा बड़ा कर देता फोटो में ब्लैक वाला हिस्सा भी दिख रहा
है नहीं वो स्क्रीन है उसके
डिफाइन सम प्रोटोकॉल्स वी डिफाइन व्हाट आवर प्रॉब्लम वी वांट टू सॉल्व एंड देन वी कलेक्ट डेटा एंड एडिट एंड द स्पेशियल डेटा देन वी डू एनालाइज वी मेक रिपोर्ट्स एंड देन वी डिसाइड एंड एक्ट सो दिस इज हाउ जीएस वर्क्स इन एवर सो मैप्स जीएस डेटा. So data in GIS represents a simplified view of physical entities, the roads, mountains, accident locations or other features which we wish to identify. So in GIS what we do is we have a physical entity and we convert it into a cartographic object or spatial features, that means symbols, point, line, polygons plus attribute data. So we try to convert the physical entity into a cartographic object or a spatial feature. By spatial feature we mean, this. So for example, in this diagram we have black is basically is representing a lake. So what we are doing now, a physical entity is represented by a spatial object in GIS. Here lake, the dark areas and the other land cover types are represented by polygons. So what we are doing is we are converting these land and lakes into polygons, right? These polygons are associated with a set of essential characteristics that define each land cover to have vegetation, ownership and values. So essential characteristics, it is very important. Essential characteristics are subjectively chosen by the spatial data developer. It is our choice. It is our choice what we want to take from this map, right? This is a subjective, we are subjectively choosing some of the features which we are interested in. We are not taking everything out of this image. So some of the features, so basically from this image we are converting some of the features into these polygons, and then we will do analysis later on, of course. So basically what is happening, we have a real world, then we are converting it into a spatial data model. We are choosing those, right? And then basically this spatial data model is again stored in the computer in the form of some, every feature has an ID, so it has an area type, and then and it also has the latitude also, right? XY latitude. And these data structures are again for the machine, they are converted into ID code 01. So it's a machine code. So level of abstraction in the representation of spatial data. Real world is a machine compatible but human obscure forms.
So
this is very important that we are using these coordinates are used to define the spatial location and the extent of geographic objects, pairs or triplet of numbers. So we are representing this polygon with these coordinates. So these coordinates are in Cartesian coordinate system, 2D system.
पनीर खोया
person, right? So similarly, so spatial vision means we have X, Y, that long, right? That long, or maybe elevation also. For 3D cases, we might have elevation information also. So, and attribute data basically corresponds to, or it helps to
further
spatial vision, but non-spatial components. So I have a color example, for example, color, HP, or you know, fashion departments.
कहाँ है ये लोग बनाते
agreed upon set. So in this case we can see that red line, solid, so these are different layers, you know, each magic layer has different properties, roles, elevation. And in GIS what we can do is, for example, we can do analysis of elevation and soils, you know. And we can see the areas where we have higher elevation and what kind of soils are found in the areas where we have higher elevation. So we can do these overlays. So coordinate data can be divided into Cartesian system and spherical system. So coordinates define location in two or three dimensional space. So in two dimension we need x, y, and for three dimensional we need x, y, and z. So basically, all over the world, right, we need some kind of a system in which we can define the location of some entity, right? Maybe we want to, we need a system in which we can define the location of that. For example, we are using GPS. So we are storing, for example, event locations. So we want to store that location, in a reference frame, right? Or in a coordinate system. So first of all, we need to understand a coordinate system which is applicable all over the world, right? So we need some kind of a coordinate system. So spatial data and GIS most often use a Cartesian coordinate system. So there are two types of these systems, Cartesian coordinate system and spherical coordinate
system.
So spatial location of the object in three dimensional world is defined as two Cartesian coordinate system. So in this case, we can have
the two
dimensional
coordinate system.
In case of a two dimensional Cartesian coordinate system, zero is going to be
webinar.
And in three dimensions, where z axis and y axis are intersecting.
महीना में 4,000 रुपए हो जाता है जूम में.
That is the Yes. So why?
Actually, those who are not listening, so kindly rejoin and you can get the audio.
Okay. So by convention, Cartesian coordinates increases from bottom to top and from left to right. Origin is defined at the intersection of the orthogonal axis. And so in the spherical coordinate system, origin is defined at the center of the earth. Okay, so this is very important. Origin is defined as the center of the earth. So basically, so in the first case, this is North Pole and South Pole, right, which is defined by this axis where the earth is revolving. So we define the location on this system, basically a spherical coordinate system. It defines location by two angles of rotation, lambda and phi, and a radius r to the point on the sphere. And we have, you know, this is Greenwich meridian, so longitude which we are assuming as zero.
Hello?
Dr. Thakur, your voice is audible.
Audible.
Hello? Hello, Dr. Saab.
Hello, Dr. Saab.
Thakur sir, aapko audible nahi hai.
नेटवर्क नहीं है क्या? कुछ नहीं आ रहा है, आपका वॉयस नहीं आ रहा है. हाँ, वॉयस नहीं आ रहा है ना, वीडियो आ रहा है, और वहीं पर पीपीटी स्फेरिकल कोऑर्डिनेट सिस्टम भी रह गया है. नहीं, आपका आपका लैपटॉप में इंटरनेट आ रहा है कि नहीं? रीजॉइन करी आप, एक आप उसको इंटरनेट को ना रिस्टार्ट कर लीजिए इंटरनेट. उसी लिंक पे फिर क्लिक करके ज्वाइन कर लीजिए. सब दिख रहा है आपको? हमारा आवाज जा रहा है? यू आर लॉस्ट एक्चुअली. जिसमें करिए सर, करिए, कर दीजिए. आपका क्या मोबाइल में आ रहा है इंटरनेट? तो फिर इसको कट गया क्यों आपका लैपटॉप में? आप बंद कर लो और ज्वाइन कर लो फिर से, कोई टेंशन नहीं है. Yeah, he has some network issue. Just wait for 5 minutes. He is going to re-login and then he'll play.
Okay, sir.
I shared the attendance link. So you have 15 minutes to give your response. By the time we will return back, so you give your response.
Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, you can feel your response,
huh? Sure, sir, sure.
Thank you.
Thank you. Am I audible now?
Yeah. You are audible.
Yes, sir. Can you share the screen, please?
Okay. I'll share the screen. Now you can share, sir.
Yes. Okay. You can see the video now.
You can go to the spherical coordinate system.
Okay.
Spherical projection.
Yeah, this one, right?
Yeah, this one, right?
Okay, fine. So I think basically in this we can see there is these 5 degrees radius circles, they are distorted on the spherical coordinate system because of the convergence of these longitudes along the poles. But when we plot these on a 2D, this two-dimensional Cartesian coordinate system, there is no distortion, but on a spherical there is distortion. Now this is again just showing how we can report these, latitude longitudes. So there are two ways, right? We can also use north, south, east, west, right? One convention is to use these letters north, south, east, west, followed by degree of rotation in that direction. For example, east, south, east. In the second convention, of 90 degrees. In the southern latitudes are positive and southern latitudes are negative. 3 eastern longitudes are positive and western longitudes are negative. And they may be recorded as degree, meters, seconds. Degree, meters, seconds. So in this case, we can see, for example, 32 degree, 45 minutes, 28 seconds. Or that there is another way of recording them, that is dd, degree decimals, that is abbreviated as dd. This is same unit is 32, 75, 77, 78. So sometimes this is very important. Sometimes we need to convert from 50 minutes second to degree decimal or maybe vice versa. So in this formula, what we are doing is we have units, we have a location. This here in degree minute second, that is 32 degree 45 seconds. 45 minutes, 28 seconds. So the formula is that degree is equal to d plus, that is your degrees plus minutes divided by 60, and seconds are divided by 3600. By doing this, by applying this equation, we can convert from degree minute second to decimal degrees. Similarly, we can convert from these decimal degrees to minutes, which is again we can convert the minutes. Now we assume that the shape of the Earth is a sphere, but we know that Earth is not a sphere. It can be represented by a ellipsoidal Earth. So basically, in that case, we have ellipsoid Earth is represented by ellipsoid, and it has two axes, basically semi-major axis and semi-minor axis. So there is some difference in this radius. On the equator, the earth has a more radius as compared to the poles. And this is a flattening factor, which is F is equal to A minus B upon A. And this is actually converting a surface distance. So this I'm just showing because so let's say we have two latitude longitudes, right? Two locations on the Earth, right? And they are lying on a great circle. So great circle basically means a plane which is passing through the center of the Earth, right? So great circle means any plane which is passing, which is cutting the Earth, and it is also passing through the center of the Earth. So if we have the great circle distance between two points on a sphere is given by this formula. So in this case, we are assuming that Earth is a sphere. So this is a good approximation. But the main point is that in this calculation we can find out the distance in kilometers. So if you have any latitude longitude, then you can apply this formula and you can calculate the distance between those two latitudes and longitude values. So in this case we are assuming in this formula basically we are assuming that our radius is approximately 6378 kilometers.
Any math you have given? So metadata tells us about the data, right, of our RGS in the environment we are working. So this is basically metadata, right? Information that is like item gain is called metadata, and this is also very important. Next slide, please. So there are two types of spatial data models. One is vector model and other one is raster model. So in vector model we store data, we store points, data as points, line, area, that is our polygon. And in raster basically we have a grid system, and in cells we can also have a information like points, lines and area. Next slide please. Next slide. So vector data model. So vector data model. So in this case, each line is made up of line segments that run between adjacent coordinates in my ordered space. So starting point and ending points for a line are sometimes referred to as nodes, while intermediate points in a line are referred to as vertices. So point, node and vertices define points, lines and polygon features in vector data. Area entities which are rows are known as polygons. Next slide.
Sir, can you show your camera in front of your face?
So in this case, it's a multiple representation of buildings. We can represent buildings either as points, or we can represent them as lines, or we can represent them as areas which are polygons, right? So we can, in this case, we can use any of these features. Next slide. So vector data. In this case, we can see that we have a vector data model, and we have numbered them as 1, 2, 3, like that, right? So this is very important to understand that in the math, in the metadata, for each this feature we have a ID, and for each row, that is one row, ID, that is Hudson Hall floor, so it is building name Hudson Hall, then we have floors, how many floors are there, six floors, room type, flat, field, stuff, so right? So this is the way in which GIS basically stores the data. An example for most famous vector data model structure graph corresponds to rows in a table. We then identify that is your ID and a set of attributes in columns. So this is how the data is stored. Right, so each all these features have a ID, and for in the one row, these different columns are storing the attribute data. Right?
डाटा
बेस
Sir, can you show your face in front of the camera?
Yes, yes. Yes, that's good. Yes,
that's good.
Okay. So better layer, better layer sometimes has managed one relationship. Let's say you have a feature and table node. In this so multi-part features vector data. So for example, in this case, we can see multi-part features. So you can see in this point ID 1, that is new code. So all these areas are representing new code. So here the counties for Rhode Island is state of so you are shown with a one table entry for each county top with multi-part features in a layer. Right? So this is a multi-part feature. So there are different polygons, but all of those are corresponding to the same ID. So this is multi-part feature. Next slide. Yes. So in this case, we can see that you know there are various these polygons, and all these polygons are representing one. Similarly, Washington. Washington County has two polygons, and the area corresponds to these two polygons. Right. So this is an example of multi-part feature. Next slide, please. This is an example of a single part feature. Here, every polygon, every closed polygon corresponds to one ID, right? And this area is only for that one polygon. For example, one new phone. So area is 43.5. Right? So here, counties so basically in this table with one table entry for each distinct polygon with only single part feature in the area. Note that calculation, analysis, and interpolation may differ for multi-part versus single-part feature. Right? So in the previous slide, we have seen that different polygons, those were representing the multi-part features for the same table. But in this case, we have one-to-one correspondence, that is single-part feature. Next slide. So converting multi-part features to a single-part feature, right? So when we are doing these conversions, then we might have some problems. We might end up having some errors. So in this case, you can see all these IDs, these are states of Hawaii. These are basically different polygons of Hawaii, and they always have a same ID 23. But when we are converting into single, we are converting them into different So the population column is coming for all those polygons, which is a error, right? Because population is combined in those. So that kind of problem we can have when we are converting from multi-part to a single part feature. So we have to take care when we are doing this kind of analysis, right? So similarly, density sum and other derived variables often should be recalculated for single part feature, but often are not resulting. Next slide. So this is representing polygon in linear boundary generalization. Basically, what we can see is that we have created a polygon, but inside the polygon there is a concrete path. So what we are doing is these are polygon inclusions are areas in a polygon that are different from the rest of the polygon, but still part of the polygon. So in this case, this is a raised landscape background. And sometimes when we are digitizing, right, boundary generalization is an incomplete representation of a boundary dimension. Right? So these approximations typically occur as a consequence of adopting vector representation, and their impact must be considered while using vector data. Next slide. So topological vector model. This is a topology is the study of geometric properties that do not change when forms are bent, stretched, or undergo single transformation. So we can see in this there are spaghetti model. In spaghetti model in figure A, you can see that some of the lines are not joined, right? So in spaghetti model, each line is recorded individually with explicit starting or ending point. But in topological model, topological vector model, you know, explicitly record topological relationships at the adjacency and connectivity in data file, right? All these lines, this L1 is running with P2. And like next is graph topology, we can have a curved line. Now there is also planar and non-planar. So in non-planar you can have crossed lines, right? And these lines are crossing and you don't have any node. But in planar topology requires that all features occur on a two-dimensional surface. For example, you can see in non-planar basically these two polygons, 1 and 2, they will overlap area, right? But when we force it to have a planar, then 1, 2 and 3, there are two nodes are created and three areas are created. Planar means that every feature is only on one plane. But non-planar, in non-planar what is happening? Polygon 2 is on top of polygon 1 and there is a overlap area. So no overlapping of features is allowed in planar topology. Next slide. Similarly, these topological groups may be forced across data layer. Right? In this case, we have two data. We have two data layers. One is housing data layer, and other is property line data. So now, when we are overlapping these two, there is an intersection of property line data layer with the housing data layer, which is disallowed overlap. So these rules may be specified to overlap between objects in different layers. Next slide. So this is how, you know, basically an example of vector features and corresponding topology table. Information on adjacency, connectivity and other spatial relationships may be stored in topology tables and joined to features by indices. Here represented by value in the ID column. So these points, they are, you know, we have a point ID, URS, and XY is the, you know, their location. And these lines, basically, for example, line 11, we have a beginning node 1 and we have an end node 1. So lines are basically found by points. And we are also have this right polygon. So A is on the right side of this line 11. Right? So all this information is stored. Similarly, we store the polygon. So polygon A is found by these lines 11, 12, 52, 53, 54. Right? Next slide, please. Okay. So basically what is happening that we user have a one view, but so for example in this case we have a geographical location 1, 2, 3, 4 and we are have an attribute ID 1, 2, 3, 4 and this is type, medium, middle and area is also recorded. But some of these you know how these are stored, so these IDs are further stored as polygons and polygons are stored as lines. And these lines are further divided into nodes and vertices, and these nodes are further divided into these NV type and XY location, right? So this line basically shows us a hidden structure which is that is how the data is stored in that situation. Next slide, please. So raster data model defines world as a regular set of cells, right, in a grid pattern. And it is good to represent continuous spatial features like elevation, precipitation, slope, occlusion, fluid concentration, and the cell dimensions and kind of cell resolution. Next slide. The number of cells in a raster data that depends on the cell size. For a given area, a linear increase in cell size causes an exponential increase in the cell number. For example, in this case, 100 meter of cell, one side of the cell, there are four cells. When we divide this 100 into 50, then we will have 16 cells. Then further, when we are dividing 50 into 25, we have 64. So basically, having a when we are having a cell size, causing a four-fold increase in cell number. Next slide. So we can also have these data types as the speed of categorical data may be represented by codes in a raster layer. For example, A represents agriculture, forestry, highway, developed area. So there are several types of these data types, and their examples are shown in the table for raster layers. Next slide, please. So raster development. Sometimes the cell labeled in A, it can contain only land. You can see that A is only having land, and B is having mostly water, and D is having also water. So sometimes some are near equal in their proportion of land and water, as in cell D. So raster cell assignment with mixed landscape. Upland areas are lighter gray and hot. So basically, in this case, what is happening that there is not a single in some cells we have, for example, three, we have land and water pole. So what kind of assignment we can do, because these are mixed cells. Next slide, please. So when we have a raster mixed cell, we have two types of approaches. One is winner take all. So one common method to assign class or mixed cell is winner take all. That is, the cell is assigned the class of the largest area type. Cell A, C, and D would be assigned land class and B, the water class, because for winner take all. And the second is, if any of an important type is found, then the cell is assigned that value regardless of the proportion. If we specify a preference for water, then cell B, C, D in figure would be assigned water type, and cell A is the land. Because if it depends upon our own specification. If we are doing this water and this one, then we can assign to their water on. Next slide, please. So raster feature and attribute table. So raster has, in this case, raster has, what we are doing is we have these 100 cells, and we are having one-to-one correspondence in the attribute table. So what will happen in this case, so this will become a large attribute table will be created. But this causes a big problem, because if we have millions of points in a raster data, then our attribute table will be very large. So in this case, raster data model really maintains one-to-one relationship between cells and attributes, because table access and performance usually suffer. Next slide. So we have raster many to one. So in this case, all the classes are so 10 class is shown and area is shown. So a many to one relationship between cells and table rows is adopted more often. Next slide. So in comparison, this is a comparison of vector and data model. So raster is really simple, vector is complex, and spatial precision for raster data is set by the cell size, and for vector data limited only by positional measurement in the field. So whether you are using a handheld GPS or a DGPS, that will determine the spatial precision of a vector data, that is limited by positional measurement. Next slide, please. So in this case, this is triangular beam reliable network. This is the TIN model, and TIN forms a connective network of triangles. And basically, what we do is we make these convergent circles which are passing through these three points, right, as shown in the diagram, and from these three points we make these triangles. And we can see that there is an unacceptable circle containing the central point. So this is an unacceptable circle. So line crossings are avoided by identifying the convergent circles for a set of three points. The convergent circle is defined as a circle passing through all three points. The triangle is drawn only if the corresponding convergent circles contain no other sampling point. Each triangle defines a terrain surface or a facet assumed to be uniform slope and extends over the triangle.
आप पूरा पढ़ रहे हो और कंप्यूटर को देख के अपना मोबाइल को ऐसे देख के ना, क्योंकि ये वीडियो जाएगा अपलोड होगा ना, इस मोबाइल को देख के इसे आगे रख के पढ़ो तो सबको लगेगा कि जैसे क्योंकि आप पूरा पढ़ दे रहे हो कुछ समझ नहीं रहा है।
सुनाओ, हेलो ऑडिबल। तो दिस इज टीम मॉडल, दिस component of same data. So in this case, next slide please. So we are representing, so we are representation of aggregation data using raster, raster and same data models. So in the first case, we have a raster. We have a raster then really in this case if you zoom in, we can see the alias of the aggregation. So we can represent basically aggregation as the tool also, that is the example of the raster, and also same, which is a 3D model of the aggregation data. Next slide. So basically in this RTS we can also convert data between raster and raster data. So in this case, first case, we can have any cell root, which is basically we are applying this conversion. So near center root, basically the line is passing to the center of the cell. So vector to raster, we have a line in the raster. So first we are converting that into point, you know, cell center point, and then we are passing it moving line. Next slide. So data and the file structure. So these basically all the data in the software is stored in basically in a binary form. ResNet for a point location. So the point is same, but you can see that for, you know, in different systems, you know, this the same point location latitude and longitude are changing. For example, NAD ABC. If you are using NAD ABC, the latitude is not the same. NAD 1896, there is a difference, right? So the point is, even though this point is fixed on the ground, when we are choosing these different survey data or some other, you know, data, then these same location is showing different latitude and longitude. And this is happening because we are using different system. Next slide. So the point is defined is specific coordinate system. It is crucial to realize that different ways of addressing the Earth curvature are deviations from idealized shape and inevitable accuracies in nature. As a rule, you should understand the coordinate system used for all your data and convert all data to the same coordinate system prior to the analysis. So this is very important. Another keyword is your RCS and analysis. Try to convert everything to the same coordinate system. Okay. Next slide. So previously, the previous measurement, they were trying to use a star to understand the what is the radius of the Earth. So they came up with a number of 40,000 kilometers. That is the circumference of the sphere of the Earth. Next slide. So we know that Earth is not a Earth is basically spheroid and ellipsoid, and I have already explained this, so I will not go into this detail. Next slide. So in this slide, the important thing is that from AD 1930, we are trying to measure the equatorial radius A and polar radius B. And these are different flattening factors. So we have so many of these ellipsoids because you can see in this table that different people or different, you know, organizations, they are trying to identify equatorial radius A and polar radius. Whenever they are coming up with these different
that even though slightly different number, they are coming up with different ellipsoids. Right? So these are basically WGS 84. This is also ellipsoid, which is used by students, right? So that's the point, right? We have big focus. Fine. Next is geoid. So geoid is basically the shape of the earth, and this is this surface is derived by using gravity data. Next slide. The geoid is measured and interpreted surface, not a mathematically defined surface. So this is very important to understand. Ellipsoid is a mathematical surface, right? We can define an ellipsoid by if we have A and B, equatorial radius of Earth and equator. But geoid, on the other hand, is a surface, is an interpreted surface which we define by gravity, right? So that means in order to define a geoid, we need to measure gravity all over the world, right? So there are various ways we can measure the gravity using gravity meter or SI data. Nowadays, from waves and other satellites, we are able to measure the gravity of the Earth from the space up. So that is increasing the number of points. So basically, what is happening is that our measurements of geoids are improving day by day. Next slide, please. So there are three types of height: ellipsoidal height, which is equal to orthometric height plus geoidal height. So this is the surface of the Earth, and orthometric height is above the geoid, and n is representing the geoidal height, which is the difference between the ellipsoidal height and the orthometric. Next slide. So geoidal height variation across the globe. So the idea is that geoidal height is different than ellipsoidal height, right? So geoid is defined by gravity and ellipsoid is defined by a mathematical equation. So the deviation of geoidal height from the ellipsoidal height is not more than 100 meters. So in this case, we are looking at these positive areas where we have to be height. Here the sea water is at a higher elevation, and we have also large negative values in the south region. So basically, what is happening is wherever we have high gravity, that is suppressing the interfacial surface, and that is also suppressing the sea surface. So we have bulges and depressions in the sea surface because of gravity, which is also causing the geoidal height variation across the globe. Next slide, please. So clearly, geographic north is different than the geographic north pole is different than the magnetic north pole, right? So next slide, the magnetic declination, basically whenever we are using a compass, the needle is always pointing towards the magnetic north pole, but that is different than the Earth geographic north pole. Next slide. So this is an example of magnetic declination showing a compass needle with positive variation in the geographic north pole. Next slide. So this slide is showing all over the world how the magnetic declination is varying all over the world. And in this, so next slide. So in this slide, basically the magnetic declination is all because Earth's magnetic field is not a fixed, it is temporarily varying. So this slide is showing how the magnetic declination is varying all over the world. Next slide. So we need to also, in order to specify heights, we need to have some data, right? Horizontal data. So horizontal data are well, in order to have horizontal data, we need to establish well established points allow us to specify a reference frame, including an origin or a starting point. If we are using an ellipsoid reference frame, we must also specify the orientation and radius of our ellipsoid. Next slide, please. A geodetic datum consists of two major components. First component is the ellipsoid, right? And basically we have spherical or three-dimensional Cartesian coordinate system and an origin. And least these three parameters in order to specify the ellipsoid. Next slide, please. And whenever we are having some datum shift, you know, this is a illustration where we are changing the ellipsoid. So whenever we are changing the ellipsoid, the location or the point location will change. You know, the landmark of the same point will change. So in this case, in this illustration, basically there are two data. One corresponds to ellipsoid A based on the fit of point P1 and P2. Right? So ellipsoid, if you see this ellipsoid A, this was made by fitting points P2 and P1 only. But and subsequent datum resulting in ellipsoid B, and based on fit of point P1 through P7. So now you see that there is another ellipsoid which is marked by this dash line. So it is basically fitted by using PP, PU, PP, almost PE6 and PE4. And this origin will again change, right? So basically, we have this datum shift because we are having more time, right? So this is the idea. When we have different datum, the location of the same point will have different latitude longitude because our orientation region has shifted, and also the points are the same, but we have more points, so our ellipsoid has also shifted. Next slide. So in this case, we have example of datum shift. So in this case, we are still looking at the same point, right? This is the same point, for example, NAD 27, you know, NAD 83. So there is a shift of 36 meters. You can see there is a shift of 36 meters. Like that, we have datum shift because we are using different ellipsoids. So that's why, even though this point is not moving on anywhere, but we are seeing this platform the series. Next slide, please. So the point is that if we have data in one coordinate system, we can convert the data into another coordinate. So what we are doing when we are doing this, first of all, let's say we have a lambda and phi platform. So first of all, we need to, this is a Helmholtz transformation. What we need to do is, first of all, we will do the origin shift, that is translation. Then we will scale it, and then we will rotate our coordinate system, and then we will convert it into a targeted Cartesian data. So basically, we are able to convert it to a Cartesian coordinate x dash, y dash, and z. Next slide. So vertical datum is formed by measuring gravity and identifying variation in constant gravity in potential surface, and combining this with carefully measured control and specified equipotential surface. So in this case, we have this orthometric height. The one very important thing is this orthometric height maybe it is not straight. Why? Because it might be just perpendicular everywhere to the equipotential surface. If the equipotential surface is varying, you might be getting an orthometric height, but it might be slightly not straight, might be curved. You know, that is very important. Next slide, please. So, map projection. So, basically, in this case, we can think of it that we are map projecting with systematic rendering of location of a curved earth surface onto a map. So, basically, what we are doing, if we have a map on a curved earth surface, we are cutting it and putting it into a flat earth. Right? So, that will cause some kind of a distortion. Because we have a ellipsoid. And from this ellipsoid, we are projecting, assume that we are projecting from the mind. In the second diagram, you can see that the distance between small a and b is less than capital A and E. But on the other hand, small d and e is greater than capital D and E. So there is a map distortion. And at point I and point I2, there is no distortion, zero distortion. Right? So map projection basically means that we are projecting a curve or something onto a flat surface. Right? Whenever we are doing this, we will have some kind of distortion. Next slide. So in in this case, approximate error is so we can see that we have an inner standard circle line of proof here where we have no error. But when we are going inside the circle, we have negative 1% error, and if we are going outside this, we have positive error. Next slide, please. This slide is again showing you that when we are projecting, a distance, we are having different distance in the same group line, right? And because of this, we are having different, and this is happening because the lifelong of the same location are changing in the projected system, and it is having different lifelong. So that's why we have in the first case we have a distance between these two points as 412, and in the second case we have a distance of 183 meters. Next slide. So any straight line basically looks like so for representation of straight lines are manifestation of projections of distortion. A great circle path shown above, the shortest route when traveling on the earth. This path appears curved when plotted on a sinusoidal projection. Next slide. So, projection surface is a developable surface that may be mathematically controlled with that surface. In this case, we can see that there is a cylinder and we are cutting it and we are rolling it and we are developable surface. And second one is a cone, and this is again we are rolling it and we are using the surface. So this is our projection surface and this is the cut line. Next slide. So we have a common line projection in ESL that is Lambert conformal coning. Right? In this case we have a ellipsoid and cone. So basically when we are having the intersection of this cone and the ellipsoid, we are having standard parallel. So wherever we have the standard parallel, we will have no distortion. Right? So this projection is known as LCC, that is Lambert conformal conic projection. Next slide. Similarly, in this case, Earth and a horizontal cylinder and the projection of Earth surface onto the cylinder. So in this case we are having, this is known as transverse mercator projection, and we are rolling along the central meridian and we are having this projection. So we will have minimum error along the central meridian, and as we move away from the central meridian, we will have these minus 2 minus 1 error will increase. Next slide. Again, in this case we are dividing the whole Earth into a UTM, Universal Transverse Mercator, and this is very helpful because in this case all the easting and northing are in meter, so it is helpful when we want to calculate area. So the whole world is divided into 60 UTM zones. Next slide. Coordinate convergence, definitely we can do coordinate convergence from one system to another. Okay. Next slide. So one thing I would like to share with you is that the most all the lines are taken from the good papers that put on geographic engineering system by Paul Bolstad. So if you read this book, you know, this is a wonderful book, and maximum all the presentation I've made are maximum slides are from this book, Paul Bolstad. And if you read this book, this is a wonderful book and you will understand most of the concept. Next slide, please. So, basically, now we are going to discuss maps and their attributes, location, and our properties. So, next slide. So, previously we had basically hard copy maps, right? And nowadays we also have digital maps, for example, Google Maps. Next slide. These are doing map, so we have different components, right? Whenever we are making map, we should take care of the region, title, scale bar, north arrow, data plane, all those things. Next slide. So in this map, we can see the latitudes also. Latitudes are the lines, you know, these lines may appear curved depending on the map scale, the map coordinate system, and the location of the area. Next slide. And in this map, we are able to see the grid. So map may also depict a grid consisting of lines of constant coordinates. The grid lines are typically drawn in both X and Y direction. Next slide. So map scale can be represented by can be expressed as map scale is the basically distance between two points on map and distance between two points on ground. So map scale can be expressed as a basically in word as a ratio or as a fraction as shown below. So large scale map, medium scale map, and small scale map. Next slide. Next slide. So small scale map, you can think of it as a, like doing a map of Chandigarh on different scales. So small scale map means you can think of it like that when we are using a camera, right? We are looking at a lot of things, right? But when you zoom in, so large scale map means you are looking at a so for example in this one, then we are looking at more detail, right? But on a small scale map, you will cover large area, but you will not see the detail, right? So that is how you can think of when we are zooming in, when we are getting in a large scale map. Okay. Next slide, please. And when we are making these maps, we have a lot of these generalizations, right? So these generalizations are shown here. We have this truth, then we can fuse it. That is truth, there are polygon truths. We can simplify this, we can display it, comment it, exaggerate it. You know, so these are different type of generalizations which we make when we are representing any features on a map. Next slide. So digitization is a process by which coordinates from a map, image, or other system are converted into a digital format in GIS. So we can do manual digitization as shown here. Next slide. So we can do hard copy digitization. Next slide, please. So this is a hard copy digitization, it's a human guided, right? Next slide, yeah. Manual digitization. So in this case, we can see the digitizing error. So error also increases, right? On a scale of 1 to 20, so this we need to take care when we are digitizing the map. So on a scale of 1 to 1 lakh, digitizing the error will be 100 meters. So next slide. Doctor, should I stop?
No, actually, up to
you, sir.
Okay, I will finish this part. Okay, the second part I will finish. Next slide. This I will explain already. So basically, there are errors when we are doing this, and next slide. So
there are
So undershoots are nodes. You can clearly see that undershoots are nodes that do not quite reach the line or other node. Undershoots are called unconnected net and unclosed polygon. And overshoots are lines that cross over existing nodes or lines. Overshoots cause difficulties when defining and analyzing line network, right? You can clearly see that overshoots, when this line is crossing, not joining, when it is overshoot. Undershoot, these lines will not join. So these are common defining errors. So we can have node snapping and line snapping. These are used to reduce undershoots and overshoots while defining. Snapping is the process of automatically setting nearby points to have a same corner. And snapping relies on a snap tolerance or a snap distance. Which next line it is shown. Next slide. Similarly, we can have line snapping. Next slide. So in this slide, we are clearly seeing that these are basically some of the tools which are provided in the software. Where these circles, next slide. Next slide, please. Yes. So in this, you can see the lines are not joining because these two points before snapping, because these dash circles, they are showing the tolerance limit. So these two points will join after snapping, as you can see on the right hand side figure. And this overshoot will be cut and it will join this line. But these two points on the top where these circles are not joining, this point will not join this point. So undershoots, overshoots and snapping. Snapping may join nodes or may place a node onto a nearby line segment. Snapping does not occur if the nodes or the lines are connected by more than snapped out.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, thank you. Dr. Sahu, I should stop here. Is that okay? Or do you want me to continue?
It's up to you, sir. Actually, I think you have covered all these things. And next lecture will be special data types and errors.
Okay, then I think I will stop here and I will take some questions if participants have.